Welcome to Virtual Insights, the Imagine Worlds of Marwencol. We're so glad you're here. And we're so glad to be joined by Jon Ronson, Valérie Rousseau, and Mark Hogancamp. My name is Persephone Allen, and I'm the manager of adult public programs at the American Folk Art Museum in New York City. As many of you know, our museum is dedicated to expanding the appreciation and understanding of self-taught art across time and place. And we're thrilled to be celebrating 6 decades of this work with our institution's 60th anniversary this year. We're grateful for opportunities like this to connect online, which would not be possible without your support. Thank you for donating to sustain ongoing virtual experiences like this one, our 60th milestone, and all of the incredible events we've organized this year. As we tune in from our homes today, we want to begin by acknowledging that our museum stands upon the unceded traditional homeland of the Lenape Delaware peoples, and we honor members of this nation, past, present, and future. This afternoon's conversation is being recorded and will be published online at a later date, and closed captioning in English can be activated by clicking on the CC button at the bottom of your screen. We'll begin today with introductions, followed by Jon and Valérie's discussion, after which Mark will join us and speak about new work before opening up the conversation for Q&A. And we invite you to share questions for our speakers throughout the program using the Q&A feature at the bottom of your screens. And we'll make every effort to answer as many of these as possible at the end. Today's conversation is inspired by our current exhibition, Photo Brut, Collection Bruno Ducharme and Company. And this is actually our final public program in connection with the show, which is on view at our galleries in Manhattan until June 6th. It brings together more than 400 works by 40 self-taught artists that present radically different ways of seeing and being seen. And it was curated by my wonderful colleague and one of our speakers today, our senior curator, Valérie Rousseau, with filmmaker Bruno Ducharme, and in collaboration with Barbara Safarova, Sam Storze, and Paula Eisenberg. We're honored and thrilled that Valérie is also joined today by noted journalist Jon Ronson and artist Mark Hogancamp. Before we take a closer look at Mark's work, I'm going to very briefly introduce our speakers. So noted journalist, screenwriter, and bestselling author Jon Ronson has written numerous nonfiction books, including which I'm sure many people here on the phone, on the call are familiar with. So you've been Publicly Shamed, The Psychopath Test, Them, Adventures with Extremists, Lost at Sea, and The Men Who Stare at Goats, which have all been international and or New York Times bestsellers. His many screenplays include the acclaimed Netflix original film, Okja, which he co-wrote with Bong-Joon Ho, and Frank, which he co-wrote with Peter Strawn. Jon is a regular contributor to This American Life, and in the UK, he has written regularly for The Guardian as a columnist and feature writer. His brilliant 2015 profile on artist Mark Hogancamp provided inspiration for today's discussion and is included in the collection of essays Lost at Sea. Valérie Rousseau is senior curator of self-taught art and art brut at the American Folk Art Museum in New York City. Since 2013, she has curated numerous exhibitions on artists from various countries, including our current Photo Brut, among many others. She has received her PhD in art history from the University of Quebec in Montreal, and her MA in anthropology from the School for Advanced Studies in the Social Sciences, Paris. Her many publications on international artists emerging outside the mainstream include Visionary Architectures from 2013 and Revealing Art Brut from 2010. Mark Hogancamp is a photographer and storyteller and prefers to think of himself as a film director. He's the creator of Marwencol, a 1/6 scale World War II era Belgian village in which he stages and photographs a complex narrative of Nazi intrigue, lesbian melodrama, and Sergeant Rock style heroics. He's represented by One Mile Gallery, and we're thrilled to collaborate with the gallery on today's program. I'm deliberately keeping his introduction very short so that Jon and Valérie can lead us in a closer look at his work and creative practice, and then we can hear directly from the artist. Sure. So at this point, Valérie, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Persephone. Welcome, everybody. I'm glad that we can welcome today Mark Hogancamp, and I'm glad as well to be joined in this discussion with Jon Ronson. So let's start right away. I would like to refer to Jon's essay on Mark and ask him what is Marwencol and how this oeuvre came to be. So that we can maybe introduce some biographical elements behind the story and give us a better idea of their encounter. Jon went to visit Mark and then he can certainly like give us his first impressions and what he gained from this meeting with Mark. So Jon.
Sure. Well, I guess for me, the story starts because I'd written a movie about outsider musicians called Frank, about which is based on a band that I played in, where the singer wore a big fake head that he never took off. So in my research for that movie, I started researching a whole load of outsider musicians like Daniel Johnston and the Shags. And so I got a bit of a reputation for somebody who, you know, loved and was quite knowledgeable about outsider music. And so an editor at The Guardian suggested that I did some stuff about outsider art too. So it was her idea for me to go and meet Mark. I didn't know much. I at the beginning, I knew that his art somehow came from a traumatic experience that had happened to him a few years earlier. And that he lived, and he'd created this land called Marwencol. So I was expecting to turn up at Mark's home in Kingston to see kind of, you know, something like Legoland, you know, some giant, you know, magical world. And by the way, I'm not the only one. I know it sort of pisses Mark off that sometimes pilgrims will turn up, like young kids will turn up and also be a little disappointed that Marwencol kind of doesn't exist. And only it exists for moments when Mark is dressing the set. I mean, when I was there, Marwencol was just a little patch of mud and some plywood outside Mark's trailer home and nothing else. And I remember Mark being a little bit pissed off that I'd come that day because the weather conditions were perfect, mainly to do with the soil, because a mud is both good for propping up the characters, but also good for the depth of the field. So I remember Mark being a little grumpy that I happened to choose a day that would have been ideal for him to be photographing the characters. So I turned up at the house and it's a trailer home just outside of Kingston, which by coincidence is basically where I've moved to now. So I live very close to Mark. Inside the trailer home, there was a lot of mannequins, and I think the first thing I thought when I walked in there was like, oh my god, this is kind of like the Kit Kat Club from Cabaret. But what became really clear really quickly was that it wasn't ironic. There was no irony there. This wasn't hipsterish. You could imagine a hipster having all the things that Mark had, but blessedly there was nothing ironic and nothing hipsterish about the endeavor. As I say, it came from trauma, and maybe I should explain what the trauma was.
Yes, I think it would be interesting to your article was about him and his experience and his trauma and how this was transfer and I would say lived through his artwork and through Marwencol. So maybe it would be interesting at first to set up what is Marwencol for many people. We do not have a sense of what the world is in permanently. If you really well mentioned that when you arrived, you were expected to see this word display on the land, and then you probably have seen photographs indoors. So yeah, I think it would be interesting if you link these two parts of the story together.
Sure. Well, Marwencol, and Mark should correct me if I've got anything wrong here. Marwencol is in Belgium. It's a fictional land that kind of is Belgium in 1940 during the Nazi occupation. But it's basically, I think it started off as a, obviously it's a form of art therapy. I think I should explain what happened to Mark, like how he ended up here. So I guess the place to start this story is Mark wakes up in a hospital bed after, and feeling not great. And there's somebody standing at the end of his bed, and he says to Mark, do you know where you are? And Mark says, yes, it's 1984 and I'm in Ibiza. And the guy says, no, it's not. He says, how long do you think you've been asleep for? And he said, I don't know, a couple of hours. And the man says, it's the year 2000. You're in a hospital in New York and you've been in a coma for 9 days because you were attacked outside a bar. And the first thing Mark said was, I forgive them. And that was the first words that came out of Mark's mouth. And the guy said, you wouldn't forgive them if you knew what they'd done to you. So what had happened was Mark was in a bar. He was an alcoholic at the time, drinking up to 2 liters of whiskey a day. So things had definitely gone off kilter. And when he was in this bar, he starts chatting to these five guys, these young teenage guys, early 20s. And alcohol being a truth serum, at one point during the evening, he admits to them that he enjoys wearing women's shoes and stockings. I can't remember whether Mark was actually wearing them that day. I think he probably wasn't. So he just told them that this is something that he enjoyed doing. So they left the bar and they laid in wait for him. And when he came out of the bar, they attacked him from behind. Mark doesn't remember anything about the attack. He was unconscious within seconds, but they carried on. They were stamping on his head with both feet. His eye, Mark's, obviously I feel bad about going into the details, but the attack was so bad, his eye came out of his head and had to be put back into his head. It was a very, very serious attack. So after Mark regained consciousness, he went through physical therapy. He was angry and obviously upset, but the therapy was slowly working. And then after some months or a year, he got a phone call from the hospital saying, you need $175 a month to continue this therapy. And Mark said, I don't have that money. And the guy on the other end of the phone said, well, I guess you don't have therapy anymore. So now Mark was without therapy. And Mark had been an artist before, I think a graphic artist. And I can't remember. But anyway, he began, in lieu of having physical therapy, to create art therapy for himself, which was this world. He created a world, and so it's Belgium in 1940, but what it really is these guys who attacked him. And over and over and over again in the photographs, Mark gets his revenge on the guys who attacked him in every way you can think of. I remember Mark saying to me, in ways that Satan wouldn't have even thought of, these guys are like hanged and I presume gutted, although that might be my imagination. But basically these men are punished over and over again. And Mark realized that each time these men get their comeuppance in this fictional world, it made him feel a little bit better. Once in a while, the person doing the punishing was Mark, the character based on Mark Hogan, or even Mark's actual hand coming in and but most of the time, the people doing the punishing are these women. And the women are based on people who Mark knows, neighbors and friends of Mark's. And they're the ones who punish these five men in the most graphic ways that you can think of, which is obviously saying something about how Mark feels as if he's in a world, feels that his world is a world of women, not a world of men.
In this presentation, you point out three elements that I would like that we develop it further in this discussion, this idea of trauma that is really like His work is directly rooted in the trauma and became a resolution of this tragedy. And then this idea of the lack of irony in Marwencol, and then this the place that he gives to women as characters and important characters in this narrative, in this story. And so let's maybe go back to this idea of the trauma that is really pervasive in the shaping of Marwencol. And you talked about this first trauma of the attack, the second trauma of not being able to afford psychological support in healing. And then Marwencol became this space where Mark could literally like relearn to walk, relearn to talk.
Yeah.
And I have this beautiful quote. He said, "I am glad to have this ability to escape into a fantasy world. Those guys, the attackers, I thought took away my imagination with everything else, but they didn't." Mm. So there's something very powerful in the way that this adventure, this artistic adventure, was a way physically, psychologically to find a resolution.
Sure. I know in the Marwencol documentary, somebody says that this would be an amazing story if Mark's art was okay or good. But it's an amazing story and Mark's art is great. And this is coming from his hands, you know, would shake uncontrollably as a result of the trauma, yet look at the intricacy of what he was doing. Plus, he'd never worked in this form before. He was learning this from scratch. So the talent came through the trauma. He was almost like it was like, you know, telling the trauma that it wasn't going to win because he was choosing something that was so difficult for him.
And an outlet as well, anger became a good outlet.
Yeah.
And a way to, as you really well mentioned, a way to replay the attack, to get revenge, and also to heal through the lives of these characters involved in the story.
Yeah, and I don't think it was ever intended to be anything other than for him, except for what happened one day was he was pushing one of his
Jeep?
Tanks, yeah, Jeep, yeah, along the road because he wanted the wheels of the Jeep to be a bit sort of, you know, used and faded. And a neighbor saw him and said, "How many miles to the gallon does that do? And Mark shouted back, 58. And they started talking. And the guy said, "Have you got any more photographs of this?" And he goes, "Oh," and Mark said, "Yeah, I've got thousands." And so this guy who was a photographer for an art magazine who lived close by to Mark saw the photographs and was just astonished. So yeah, trauma, but also, what was the second one that we were gonna?
The irony.
Can I talk a little bit about this?
Because
I think.
But Jon, there's something before you move forward that you just pointed out that is very important. It's like this moment that Mark was discovered by creating his artwork and pushing this Jeep alongside the main road. This is the moment as well where there's a certain control that escaped him in a way that he realized that it was not just intimate, it was just not personal, it became something that people were curious about and they wanted to know about. And he was quoted in the film saying something, he said, "My mind can't decide what world to go for, real world, but there's danger out there. People out there are so real. I feel safe in my town. I prefer to live in Marwencol." So there's something about this that at this moment where-
The world he can control. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
It escaped the creator and there's all the time this back and forth between the comfort zone of creating something intimate that that is part of the healing process and then to keep a certain distance between the others who are interested in knowing more and get into this world and your capacity to heal through something like this.
Yes, yeah. Absolutely. It's a world that you can control. I really understand this. I remember years ago, a friend of mine said, you know, you stay in your, said to me, you know, you stay in your little room all the time because the outside world is too big and frightening. So you just want to stay in your little room constructing stories. And I guess it's the same impulse to be able to, yes. to control your world. And this is a kind of ultimate form of control because over and over again, Mark's attackers are getting their comeuppance. Yes, it's an entirely safe world. Maybe not entirely safe to build the world though, because I know that like the windows of the bar in Marwencol come from bits of glass from when car windows have been broken near his neighborhood and so on. So I assume that some of the, that there's some danger involved in some of the foraging for materials, but who knows? That's something I'd quite like to ask Mark. But yes, but I have no doubt that Mark prefers the world of Marwencol to the outside world. My guess is that nothing about Mark's fame is appealing to him. I think he doesn't like it when people turn up what he could be photographing, which is what happened with me. He doesn't like it when pilgrims turn up and they sort of sit at his feet like he's a guru. He just wants them to like go away. I presume he doesn't like the fact that there was a big Hollywood movie made.
Right. John, he was saying as well that he felt like, he said, like, at first it was something, it was my comfort, it was my therapy. And he felt like at some point, like everybody wanted to play with his world and wanted to be part of this world. He said, I don't want it. This is the one last thing that I don't ever want taken from me. So you have this dichotomy between, you know, in this initiative of and the interplay between the intimacy and the social acceptance or recognition of his works and the exhibition that was successful exhibition, his first solo show at White Collins in 2006 really gained the attention, the public attention and recognition of the art world. And there was this very positive article by Jerry Salt in The Village Voice. And so, yeah, there are this, the art world is shaped with a system of, you know, peers recognition and networks and the market. And I feel like, as you point out, that this, the profile of Mark doesn't fit the profile of a traditional artist that has to deal with everything else that comes with it. And this is a very particular position that many outsiders and self-taught artists are having.
Yes. And the other thing that I think a lot of outsider artists have in common is, and musicians, is the absence of irony, which I find really interesting. I noticed this when I was writing my movie, Frank. So the band that I was in with the guy with who wore the big fake head was a comedy band. And I just sort of felt, well, we can't. This isn't going to work if the band aren't going to take themselves seriously. And so when I started researching other outsider musicians, like especially Daniel Johnston, who all inspired the movie Frank, Daniel Johnston, the Shags, the Captain Beefheart to an extent, the one thing that they all had in common was an absence of irony. So I noticed that as a motif. And I think the same is true for the outsider artists. I mean, is there Mark... there's no irony in Mark's work. To my knowledge anyway, I mean, it feels like a very serious, earnest, important, you know, ripped from the heart endeavor. And maybe that's something that unites a lot of outsider artists. When I looked at the wonderful exhibition, the exhibition that Mark's a part of, that's at the museum at the moment, is just wonderful. I really recommend it. And I think that's something that many of the artists have in common. They take themselves very seriously. And I think that's a very important part of outsider art. It's lack of irony. It's almost as if it's too important to be ironic. I mean, with Mark, this is like him fixing himself, like he was broken and he's fixing himself. There's no room for irony in that. I really admire the lack of that. It makes it so much more special.
Yes, you feel almost like it's a lifelong movie when you look at the photographs. There's no end, there's no beginning, and all these images are merging together. And so you have a sense that they are not isolated scenes and that he really cares for his characters during he makes these scenes and after the scenes are photographed. This is not something that is for a moment. This is in continuity. So indeed, there's a this is a common characteristic with many artists included in this exhibition, Photo Brut. So, you know, the artist is in the work and the work is in him. And it's not something that is fragmented. And, you know, often we talk about authenticity, which is a term that is very controversial, but you have this feeling that that you don't see a lot of this type of works in contemporary art, because art is not a profession. Art is a way to live, and you have the sense this is a lived experience. And I found, maybe we can look at other slides. The next, yes, it's an example here. But so you, to person this lack of irony, first of all, we can talk about the psychology of the characters. What struck me at first when I look at his photographs is this ability that Mark has to manifest the psychology of the characters. You know, we all often think that plastic dolls are having neutral expressions, or you know, you can make things out of them, but they are like standardized. And then he has refined a kind of way of adapting them and molding them for his own story with such brio. And so we can feel the hates, you can feel the tenderness, you can feel the love of his in his scenes and his characters. And you mentioned something also interesting when you talk about the Jeep that was pushed along the road. So let's say this is not like he aged you know, the trucks by sending the wheels. No, he needed to carry the Jeep across the road for the Jeep to be aging across time. And this is something that is, again, it's not faking aging. It's also playing and walking through aging with this element of his story. And I think it's a good example of how this lack of irony transfers, is visible across across the works.
Yeah, to the actual making of the works too. I think that photograph is very kind of, you know, this is kind of what Marwencol calls about, that this is an injured man being comforted by a woman. And it's the women who are getting the revenge on behalf of Mark much of the time. There's a lot in Marwencol about, I suppose you'd say, the veneration of women. It's like Marwencol's it's a tribute to women. Women didn't let Mark down. It was five male bigots who let Mark down. Five horsemen, I remember Mark called them, that he was drinking so much, you know, who knows how long he would have lasted. And then he said to me, God sent me five horsemen of the apocalypse. Can I just go off on a very quick tangent about something that's so interesting? So when Mark woke up after 9 days in a coma, he was no longer an alcoholic. It had just gone. And he's never had a drink since, to my knowledge. And the reason why is because when he got home, he saw all of these women's shoes in his home. And he thought, what was I into, women's shoes? Because he had no memory of his life before the trauma. He would watch wedding videos of his marriage to his former wife, and he just wouldn't remember her. He didn't remember that part of his life at all. So he was looking at all of these, you know, women's shoes. And he was thinking, well, I used to be into this. And so he sort of put a pair on and immediately felt it. Like immediately he was back. So that was so deep. That the brain injury couldn't take that away. And that's the reason why Mark hasn't drunk alcohol, because if the wearing of the women's shoes was that deep inside, then maybe the alcohol would be as well. So the veneration of women. And I think that's something that's across much of the artists in the current exhibition, right?
Yes, talking of these characters, one of his beloved one is Anna. She's recognizable with the two braids, if I'm not wrong, on her head. She's wearing braids, and she will became his wife as well. But that was quite beautiful, a beautiful moment in the documentary where he explained that he was referring to a scene where she saved his alter ego from the SS soldier who kept him prisoner. And he said, "She loved me like I love her. This is a proof of love." And he was talking about his love for his real love for these characters. And there's this moment in the documentary where you see the three women characters tucked in a little bed under his light, close to his bed, and he was like already taking care of them before he went to sleep and before they went to sleep. And he said, "If they are happy, it means I feel better." So this is really, again, this is not something that stops once the click of the camera has captured the scene. This is something that is a permanent and ongoing lifelong movie. And I found it this really revealing and beautiful.
Yeah. Also, even though Mark's life is relatively small, I think he stays home most of the time, making Marwencol, avoiding celebrity events. The photographs are leading the most incredible lives and having the most amazing ripples. I was wondering, Richard, will you go on to the photograph that probably Mark's most famous photograph of the... Oh, okay, so here's...
This one is a scene where you have the soldiers be hung from... I don't know if it's big enough, but they are hung from above.
These guys, obviously they represent the people who attacked Mark outside the bar. But can you go to the really famous photograph of the major?
Yes, towards the end. Can
rescuing
the
major. The
slides to the next one.
That one. So this photograph in particular has incredible ripples. So I first noticed it when Caitlyn Jenner first announced that she was Caitlyn Jenner, and conservatives were very annoyed. And one guy on Facebook found this photograph and said, this is what a real man looks like. Look at what this man's doing, saving his comrade from war. This is a man, not Caitlyn Jenner. So all these people on Facebook will go, well, actually, that's not a man, it's a model. And it's a model created by an artist who was a cross-dresser who was beaten up by bigots. And the guy who first posted this photograph had a revelation. It was like, that can't be a coincidence that I chose this photograph. So basically the guy was like, oh my God, I am a bigot, and this can't be a coincidence. So it was like a kind of message from God. I hope I'm not reading too much into what he was thinking, but it's like, here's a message from God that I need to take my life on a different course because he had chosen that photograph. And this photograph it often comes up on Twitter from conservatives saying, you woke idiots, this is what a real man looks like. And each time it happens, people very happily tell the bigot the backstory behind the photograph.
That's a great example of how images has been, I mean, someone has been tricked by an image and it changed the course of his or their thinking. So when we see a scene like this one, it reminds me that many works, many photographs in the exhibition, Photo Brut, were under the section like performances, because they somehow they are expression of a kind of a protocol of performance. They are created in series over time, and in the case of this photograph, Mark has probably like worked multiple hours to create these scenes with the perfect light. You mentioned how the light is important in the creation of these scenes. It works mainly outdoors, even though like you have some of the scenes, they look indoor, they are constructions that are made outdoors. But so these group of artists are working overtime, a long time period in taking snapshots or our photographs capturing scenes taking over time. And this is a large selection in the exhibition. And I think that what I am forced to think when I'm looking at an image like this one is the idea that so this world that he has created seems to be something constructed for a specific moment, but then the characters over a period of, we talk about like 15 years, 20 years, took a life of their own. And I found it very revealing in a conversation I had with Mark, where in which he was explaining that then the characters are telling them what to do, almost as they came alive, and they came alive in his own life, and they are dictating the scenes to come and to develop. And he was talking about the way how his mind doesn't go as fast as the scenes dictate the next step to be. So there's something about this that I found extremely interesting and revealing about how finally the trauma became Marwencol, and Marwencol had a life as a life of its own now that is growing with Mark, but has taken over over time.
We had a request to show some more of the photographs. So yes. Can we see some more of Mark's photographs? And maybe if you want to, I know Mark's going to come on really soon, but talk a little bit about some of the other artists. So these are some of the, okay, so this is Mark's work.
In the section about veneration of women, so you have examples where, and scenes in indoor scenes and outside scenes, which is a recurrent element in many works by outsider artists, the way that they are venerating women in scenes that almost like, I would say they are a midway between the goddess and venerated woman, in a way that they are idealized women and not so much like day-to-day examples of women.
Yeah. And some of the women are based on real women in Mark's life. So Marwencol is Mark, Wendy, Colleen?
Colleen.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And Colleen is a neighbor of Mark's who I think is really happy that she's featured in Mark's world, and she gives Mark her shoes and so on. But then Mark, but then at one point Hoagie, I think, marries Colleen in the magical world, and the real Colleen is like, I'm not sure about that. But really loves Mark's work. And yeah, the veneration of women comes up in a lot of your photographs. So for instance, can you show the photograph of the homeless guy who would photograph women?
Oh yeah, Tihi.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is further away. Yes, just after this one. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, can you talk a little bit about that? Because again, it's about the veneration of women.
Yes, so here you have examples of photographs taken by Tihi. So Tihi died in 1983. He was someone who dropped out of the Fine Arts Academy of Prague, and in the 70s he renounced painting and went to photography, and he was a guy who was rejecting the norms and end up living in the streets. And so he built his own cameras and to save money. I know that he used also 60 millimeter films cut in half. And so he was mainly making pictures of women from the streets, outdoors, scenes in parks, in swimming pools. So he was putting his camera from under his jacket and took like snapshots when needed. So I would say like, so the scenes, I have four examples here, but I would say that they are often taken like not full size. So you see like you are see on the first one on top, you see like the legs, and it's not
because he's not got a viewfinder. Yeah, that's because he's doing it covertly. So he's not looking through a viewfinder. He's just sort of pointing and shooting as best as he can, right?
I think it's intentional as well, the way that he seized the motif that he really wants to. And I know that when you look at many of the photographs, you can see this recurrent interest for some elements, some body shapes, like the triangulation. You see a lot of triangles and angles that he has captured. So it's this kind of catalog of body shapes and viewpoints that are not often seen in photography of women. You know, you have like these moments that are quite unusual in terms of viewpoints of women.
As Jay just said, one of the people watching, people do get arrested for doing what he's doing in these photographs. And I suppose, so obviously this is an issue of consent. I get, you know, maybe the difference between, the night before I went to see the exhibition at the Folk Art Museum, I was watching a documentary about Gustav Klimt, and I saw real parallels between, you know, insider artists like Klimt and the way, you know, that they venerate women, and the outsider artists in the exhibition. But I guess the difference is one of consent. The women in Klimt's drawings, paintings, knew that they were being painted.
That would be a great question to ask Mark about the consent. About what is the limit, and I think that one of the questions I think we are maybe ready to get into this part of the conversation and inviting Mark to join us.
Cool. And we're also Janet saying at the same time that can we see some more Marwencol photographs while Mark is...
Oh yeah, good. So think that they have turned off the slideshow and Mark is here.
Hello.
Hi. Hey. Mark.
It's so nice to see you again, Mark.
It's so good to see you too, man.
Did I say anything that was factually incorrect?
It was vodka, 2 liters of vodka a day, not whiskey.
Right.
Because whiskey smells and people could smell it on me, but vodka was a little bit more easy to disguise the odor on my breath.
Right. Since I saw you, I haven't seen you for like 6 years. I mean, how have things changed in your life in the last 6 years? Has you, go on.
It's been very good. Actually, I've worked a lot of things out. I mean, I've created my own therapy. So, or therapies, plural. Because I don't know. I have no guidance, no nothing. It's just whatever I feel is correct that'll cure me, that'll repair me. And I know every time I go to sleep, my brain is repairing itself. But there's some things that are damaged beyond repair in my brain. So, but I still keep striving. Now, instead of 1/6, I'm working on 1/35th scale stuff. And that's Hoagie, that's me, that's little 1/35th scale Hoagie, and his machine gun girls, his girls with machine guns, and the name of the tank is Scrunchy.
Has it gotten easier? Like for instance, things like your hand shaking and so on, I guess that's gotten better over the years, right? So has the creation of the art got easier as you've become healthier?
I hate to say, but the 1/6 scale world is still asleep in my head from the winter time. So to keep busy and to keep my mind working on dexterity and, you know, repairing things, that's why I work on the smaller stuff to keep it flowing, to keep my mind going. I'm working on a diorama now where there's a German staff car with all the German officers in it. with a briefcase with plans for the invasion of Belgium. And can't let that happen. And so there's a German traffic cop, and he stops the traffic, the staff car, because there's a girl with a bicycle, a woman, and she's in a dress, suit, like top, you know, really nice looking, sharp and everything, except she's not wearing a skirt. Just her underwear, garter belt, and stockings are showing. And that's a traffic stopper. And there's a reason for that. And another German cop is giving her directions, you know, you have to go this way. But there's a two sides to this diorama. On the roadway, this is what's happening. The traffic cop and the chick with the bike and everything. But then you turn it around, and inside the houses, up in the top floor, I have one of the machine gun girls ready to mow everybody down in that staff car. And there's going to be one girl in the shed that's going to do the same thing. It's just no one's going to live except the girl in stockings, because she's part of it. They're my girls in 1/35th scale. Anything to stop the Nazis.
Right. Which is say, by the way, that people will probably assume that that's your house, but that's not your house. That's your gallerist's house, right?
Yes,
Janet.
Yes.
Because your house, you don't have Wi-Fi in your house, so the Zoom would have been too erratic. Is Marwencol currently existing? Is there stuff happening in, you know?
Well, there's still a Marwencol. It's three buildings big. So far, there's a catfight club, the new one that I built. And I figured we can't just have one building. So I built Vampirella's own building. Vampirella, I built a coffin for her. She's in the coffin. She's beautiful. She's the only seamless doll that doesn't have all this fingerprints and dirt and stuff all over her.
I just got a really good question. I didn't see, from Lynn, and it's a question that I'm really interested in as well. How did you settle on Belgium, Nazi-occupied Belgium, as I guess a metaphor for what happened to you?
My German grandfather was in the Luftwaffe, and he had a BMW with a sidecar, because he was the mechanic that repaired all the anti-aircraft guns for the Luftwaffe when they were going along in a convoy.
Right.
And so he carried all his tools in the sidecar. And I said, Opa, did you have a machine gun on the sidecar? He says, no, not until we got into Belgium. And for some reason, I remember that, and that's why I picked Belgium, just.
Huh. But was it, I mean, I've always assumed that these guys who attacked you were, you know, of a white supremacist type of intent, because they attacked you because they were bigoted against the cross-dressing. So I always kind of assumed that was the Nazi connection.
That's why, you know, Nazis, they're like evil. I always liked World War II. I've always been interested in World War II.
Right, and your grandfather was in the Luftwaffe.
Right.
God. How are you with your ever-increasing fame? One of my main memories of being with you was the fact that you were very grumpy about fame and success. Like you really, it was a bad byproduct of the photography. Do you still feel that way about fame, or are you more at peace with it?
No, it's my people who are famous. These, my dolls, my figures, my female figures, my actors, the Nazi actors, all of them, they'll They're the stars. They're the celebrities, not me. I'm just a puppet master. I got sucked up into their fame. I don't know how, but I did. And so I'm just along for the ride. These are the people that are all in the movies, not me.
I was wondering, Mark, if you can walk us through, you know, the process of creating a scene by itself, because I see that the world that you have created is kind of frozen in time. I mean, the characters over 15 years have not changed. They are still right. Like between this age of 25 and 30 years old. So are you, a film fan? Are you watching films? Are you gathering images, going through magazines and gathering sources that help to feed your mind in terms of the creation of the scenes that you make?
Well, actually, yes. It starts with the feeling. It starts with me, like, how do I feel that day? What do I want to film? What kind of a scene do I want to set up? What's going to be intriguing? What's going to be interesting? What's going to be tangible? What is going to make sense? But in my world, nothing makes sense. So I watch movies. I watch how other directors tell the story with the characters that he has, you know? And so I'm like, all right. I watch a lot of silent films also, because my still photographs have no sound. So how can I portray a moment, a suggestion? How can I portray it in words with just one picture and no one saying anything? How can I do this? So I watch silent movies to see how they do that. And then I watch, other movies like the spaghetti western, Sergio Leone, the way he does a large, landscape shot of the town, and then the next shot is inside the town, and the next shot after that is some dude's boots, cowboy boots, walking up the steps. Stuff like that. I learned from other film directors how to tell my story, and I watch silent films on how to pose and get the message through in one shot.
Any
silent shot.
I presume that you keep all the different characters and costumes and elements from the scenes and in different boxes. How do you organize all these materials to so that's ready when you need them?
Well, there's just a path through my house because everything is in bins. Every one bin has all of the clothing in it for the female figures. Another bin has all of the clothing in it for all of the uniforms in it for U.S. troops. And another one is just German clothing for the, Wehrmacht and just regular, uniforms. And it's, and then one bin I have all the Nazis, all the SS. Another bin I have, actually it's a bin and a half, big bins, bin and a half of women, female figures. And then I have loads of vehicles. I have too much stuff. And then the two buildings for the town weren't big enough because of COVID. And because I have a nurse living next door to me, I built a huge hospital big enough so I can get into it and close the door behind me, and painted it all white, put a big red cross on the end of it facing the road, and I put thank you and the red cross in the middle. So every time night that nurse comes home, she sees thank you. And
is this in the same place where you were living 6 years ago?
Yes.
So then there was no real indication of Marwencol. As I say, it was like a stage set between sets. It was just
you were there when the church was up, right?
Maybe, but it was definitely like, it wasn't like going to a model village. It was like going to a Hollywood set when nothing was being shot.
All right, well,
Yeah. All right, so that must have been the old town, and pour that down, because I my mind needed something new. So a fan of mine donated a bunch of plywood to me, used plywood. She got her roof done, and the roofers were throwing off all this scrap plywood, which are like huge pieces. And I don't need that big of a piece to, you know, or pieces to build something. So she donated it to me, and I built the ruined stocking cat fight club in Marwencol. That was the first. It's so big, I can get into it and close the door behind me.
Wow. So that's permanent.
Yes, it's huge.
Right. So now if pilgrims turn up unannounced, they will have something to look at.
Exactly. And there's no more Nazis. It's just like your average, everyday, generic from central casting bad guys, you know.
Does that mean that there's a change in your feelings about getting revenge? Yes.
That means
gone.
I wouldn't say it's gone. I wouldn't, but I would say that it's not superficial. It's not on the surface anymore. It's still somewhere inside me where I still haven't gotten closure. I still haven't gotten anything tangible that I can hold on to and say, all right, I got something back for that.
So nothing's ever happened. I always had this fantasy that maybe, you know, you'd get an apology or something, but nothing like that's ever happened.
No.
They must know. I mean, they must know what you're doing because it's become so famous.
They must know that I've killed them for 14 years as Nazis. By women.
Mm. A quick question before we go to the public and we open to the Q&A. I was wondering where you place the photographic process in your art practice. Do you see the photos as final artworks or documentation of these scenes or both of them? And maybe to know if you do as many photographs today of these more recent scenes. Yeah, how do you position your photographic practice within the whole project of Marwencol?
Well, Marwencol, the actual physical doing stuff, comes first. The camera is the only way that I can document it, to record it in some way of what I've done that I can look back on and say, wow, I need to change that, or it'd be better if there were a couple more people in this photograph, and then I reshoot the whole thing. And I just do everything by feel and from what I learned from watching movies. I don't have a car, I don't have a iPad or cell phone or whatever. I have a landline phone, computer, and a television, that's it. That's almost like pioneer days. Like colonial days. But hey, I don't need all that other technology. You know, I just need my world and a camera so I can record it and document it, what I've done for future family members of mine. You know, look what your great great grandfather did, you know. But anyway. And I still draw. I practice drawing when I can. So.
A question came in, is there a book of your photographs that I can buy? And there is, right? There's a big coffee table book called Welcome to Marwencol. Is that
right?
And we can put that link in the chat, but I wanted to, we've had just an incredible number of questions coming in from members of the public, and I wanted to thank all of the speakers. This has been so beautiful, and I think we've all been seeing in the chat a lot of appreciation for hearing about this work today. So I'm going to combine some of the questions that we've had, and a big topic of interest has been, Mark, how do you source the outfits for your dolls? Do you have someone who makes those for you? Do you make them? And could you also talk about how you found these expressive dolls, especially when you were just starting out? Do you buy things secondhand? Are you getting, are these gifted? Okay.
Figures, this is Steve McQueen. All right, and they come in a box like this with their clothing on, and there are places that I, that 1/6 collectors can order special clothing from, and there's people that, that actually make clothing certain, but you know, that's, it's a little more expensive. But I just purchased a figure like this. It comes in a box, all fully dressed and everything. And when I open up the box, I get, right away, I get a scene in my face, in my head, like, I know what's gonna happen with you. And so that's that part of it. And what was the second part of the question?
How, where do the outfits come from? How do you choose the outfits? Does someone make them for you?
It's World War II, so I mean, like I said, they come like this already in a box. You can get actually modern day people, modern day military, even back from Napoleonic days, those kinds of figures, but that's for collectors and stuff. But with me, instead of putting them on a shelf, I put them, I play with them, I film them, I make them do stuff, I make them get dirty, you know. And of the facial expressions, that was the second half of it. I just take whatever facial expression they have when I'm shopping, look at the faces first, and I'm like, all right, can I do something with that? All right, yeah. And so I'll, when I have the money, so I'll get that figure, and I'll put them right to work when I get home, because while I'm waiting for them to get there to my house, I'm already figuring out what scene I want to build up and shoot. And a couple of times they just got there, I took them out of the box and ran outside and put them right in the ground and started filming. So that's a...
So it's a really intentional, there's a lot of thought that goes into the selection of these specific dolls.
Yep.
I think people were really fascinated. We do have someone who's mentioned that she created a fur coat.
I still have it, and Deja wore it this past winter. It fits her, that's her favorite coat. That coat never goes into a bin with other clothing. It stays separate, it's on Deja's bed, so it, so I know where it is all the time.
Well, Christina just wrote, I'm honored. We have another question here that comes from George, who asks if you have any interest in the work of living artists today, or do you have favorite historic artists that you could speak about?
Can I add a question to that too? If Mark's seen the exhibition that he's in at the Folk Art Museum, are there any particular artists in that exhibition whose work he feels akin to?
Modern artists, I don't get anything from it. My mind doesn't work like that anymore. It's been rearranged, it's been broken, it's been repaired and then broken again and repaired again. And I don't even pay attention to modern artists. I don't consider what I do an art form. It's just, for me, it's for recording historically what I'm doing. You know, it's not purposely to put out there for art or anything, but it's cool that everybody thinks it looks like art. That's cool.
And what about in the exhibition? Have you seen the exhibition, Mark?
No.
It's very good.
I don't my mind doesn't work that way anymore. And Monet and Manet were some of my top old-time artists, classic artists that I like, and Degas, of course.
But you mentioned all filmmakers are important, though. You talk about Tarantino and other filmmakers that are influential in your art making.
Yes, and the way Zemeckis makes movies, I love his movies. But I think Tarantino movies are more like what I film, what I put together with, you know, these figures. It I don't know.
Did you, if this is too personal a question, just don't answer it, but did you stay away from the whole Hollywood experience, or did you get involved in the making of the Steve Carell movie?
Nope, I stayed away. I don't want to fly, even though I'm dressed like a pilot. My biggest fear is flying, even though I've flown all the way over to Germany with my mother when I was 9. So, I mean, I stayed out of the scene. I figured I'm an artist. Nobody messes with me and tells me how to do stuff. Mr. Zemeckis was making a movie. I didn't want to bother him. I didn't want to interject anything in there. He's the artist. He has it in his own mind, you know, what he wants to do. And I just didn't want to be part of it because I'm still working on bettering myself. I'm still working on my therapy. So there's like no time for Hollywood to get involved in that stuff. If they want to do something, that's cool. Let them have fun. Yeah.
To be honest, like I've been involved in a few films and I've visited the set on every occasion. And on every occasion, I kind of end up wishing that I hadn't visited the set. For one reason, like they get very excited when you show up. But if you're still there after lunch, they're starting to wonder, like, what the hell are you still doing?
You know, like you know.
It's like, if you've got nothing. And also, you're one of the few people on the set who has nothing to do. So you end up just sitting with the hair and makeup people, who are always, like, delightful to sit with. But it's a little weird. You're sitting with the hair and makeup people, watching hundreds of people be incredibly busy. It's not, you know, after a few minutes, you're thinking, I shouldn't be here. So I think you made the right decision.
Well, it's just my mind wasn't there. It wasn't like, oh, I want to strive to be, you know, to go to Hollywood someday, and then all of a sudden that happens. I'm like, wow, take the first plane out there. No, no. After the attack, I closed myself off from everyone, the world. That's it. I can't drive because I still can't divide my attention. And I figured, all right, I'm alone. What do? My therapy's been cut off now. What do? And this is way before I had Scrunch, Deja. And so I had to, on my own, make a decision. I never, ever want to drink again. I have 21 years sober now. That night in 2000 was the last night I ever got drunk. And I don't even remember it.
has your memory improved?
Oh, yeah. I'm remembering stuff from when I was two years old. Huh. Like, just staying sober for so long has brought back such clarity to my mind. As my brain's being repaired, it's starting to remember things, you know. And I am grateful that my God gave me a second chance. Said, no, you're not ready yet, man. And laid me back on that Westchester Medical Center bed and opened up my eyes.
Mark, it's such an incredible and powerful story. And I can see that everyone on the call today is taking a lot of inspiration from hearing from you. And I just wanted to share another question that came to us. And this is that it's looking at your process again. And could you talk about how long it takes you to capture the perfect shot? And when you know it's ready, when you've got that image, that photograph that captures what you're most interested in?
Well, first of all, I run outside, I set up the scene. I set up the scene the way I have it in my head. I come back in the house, I turn on Radiohead loud so I can hear it way out wherever I'm filming. And I get out there and I get on my knees and I get down low to the level of the scene, the people in the scene. I get right into it. It depends on what scene I'm filming. If it's really a one with a lot of feeling and the Radiohead's in the background, I start crying. I'm filming, I have to wipe my eyes, I have to take a break, I have to smoke a cigarette. Yes, I still smoke. And then I get right back to it again before I lose light. But that's what I like. I want to feel the scene that I'm filming. I want to be in it. And that if it requires music in the background, you know, and just being down as low as they are on their level brings me even further into the scene. Did that answer the question, do you think? I don't know. I'm doing my best.
Absolutely. I think that was perfect. And I think we have time for just one more question. We just had a comment in the chat, such a remarkable artist. And I fully agree. Mark, could you speak to how do you know when you're, well, will your healing ever be complete? Is this a journey that you imagine being on for forever? Could you talk a little bit about the healing journey for you?
Lately, I haven't been seeing a future for myself. And like, I used to project and see like where I want to go and what goals, long-term goals I want to shoot for. And lately I'm just not feeling it. And I think that's why the decline in interest in Marwencol or filming 1/6 is happening now. It's just, I think it all started with COVID, you know, which even though I'm home all the time, when I go out to the store, I have to wear a mask. I don't care, but you know, it's cool. I can be someone else. but when I get home, then I'm working on my shed, which all the stuff out of my shed I had to bring up in my house. And that's another reason why there's just pads to walk through, because until I get my shed fixed, and there's a lot on my mind at certain times. Like right now I should be filming with those little forget-me-nots, like in that picture of the tank, all little flowers and stuff. They're out right now and they're in a field, and I mean, like in my neighbor's yard. But I just don't have, and I don't want to go out and film something false. I don't want to just film something that's stupid. And what, you know.
You know, I don't know why, but I think COVID has done that to a lot of people, made them think I don't know what my future is.
Yeah, I'm depressed. I mean, yeah. Not the point where I want to jump off a bridge or anything, but it's like I'm like just mildly depressed, where I don't feel like doing anything. And if working on this little stuff still keeps that little spark in the engine of imagination going, then I'll do it, you know. But I think it'll go on forever, to answer your question. I think repairing myself will go on until the day I die. And when I die, everyone else dies, because all of them neither of them have a personality anymore. They can't move, they can't be filmed, so, and I want Scrunchie buried with me. I want her in my casket with me, right on my chest. So when they dig me up in a million years, they'll think it's some kind of an Egyptian. So sarcophagus, not esophagus. That's, but anyway. I live in a cave. I mean, I live in a dome. It's like, yeah, the only women I see are on television. That's it. Or the nurse, neighbor, you know. or the women in my town, that's it. So I'm not used to talking to other people. So I apologize if I'm a little scatterbrained.
Again, we've all been in COVID land.
We're all still in COVID land. Yeah.
And we want to share these messages that are coming in the chat right now, where we're hearing so many words of thanks for sharing your story and sharing your art with us. And I want to extend this thanks to John and Valerie today for leading us through this really insightful closer look. It's just been wonderful to listen to the three of you. And we all feel that distance, but you've brought us slightly closer today. So we thank you for this. And we want to let everyone know that we will publish this recording so you can revisit it. We'll send that to everyone who's registered for the program today. And we hope that you'll follow John's work, Mark's work, the American Folk Art Museum's work, and of course, if you're able, visit the exhibition in person to see Mark's photographs, and that is on view until June 6th. So thank you again. This was just beautiful.
You're welcome.
Thank you.